Hold it, fellas. That don't move me. Let's get real, real gone for a change. Oh, yeah. And I can't see the shade. The low-down Rockabilly. Rockabilly blues.
Rockabilly blues. Rockabilly blues. Rockabilly blues. It's time to get real gone on the Rockabilly and Blues Radio Hour. Here's your host, James Riley.
Hey, this is Jammin' James Riley on your favorite hour for great music and interviews. It's the Rockabilly and Blues Radio Hour. Now, this hour we speak with Rock and Roll Hall of Famer John Fogerty.
I treasured music and how I related to it all my life, and Julie gave that back to me, and I'll be grateful the rest of my life for that.
We've got so much more coming up in just a little bit. We'll talk about his brand new book, Fortunate Son. But first, let's kick things off with a song he felt was a tribute to the Sun Record sound he dearly loves. It's Creedence Clearwater Revival and Green River on the Rockabilly and Blues Radio Hour. Hey, it's the Rockabilly and Blues Radio Hour, and on the phone, we are so honored to have Mr. John Fogerty. John, how you doing today?
I'm doing great, James. Thank you.
Man, it's so cool. Rock and Roll Hall of Famer, Grammy Award winner, and now author of Fortunate Son, My Life, My Music, just a fantastic book. What made you decide to do the book now?
Well, most of the push really came from my wife, my wonderful wife, Julie, who figures pretty prominently in my life, and so therefore in the book, of course. I'm not sure I would have ever, you know, kept going, let's say. I learned after a while when I got into it, boy, writing a book is a lot harder than I thought. I guess that comes, you know, if you're telling the truth.
Sure.
I suppose if you're writing fiction, you can just say whatever you want. But I had to do a lot of, double-checking myself, make sure it got written down the way I said it, that kind of thing. Certainly, there's a lot of detail, so you're just always making sure that it's the right stuff. It's kind of like making a record, actually.
Well, you got my attention early in the book, literally from the introduction, and I was just captivated the whole time. And you, several times in the book, you talked about motivation for a song just hitting you. And I'm reading the book, and all of a sudden, a lyric of yours pops in my head, and it was just an interesting metaphor, and I'll read it to you. It's, of course, I feel weird reading your own lyrics to you, but from Lodi, just about a year ago, I set out on the road seeking my fame and fortune, looking for a pot of gold. And I realize your pot of gold isn't the fame and notoriety, it's the music and ultimately family. And you found your pot of gold.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I was driven, you know, from, or I would say fascinated as an infant, really, with music. I didn't quite know what it all was. It took me years to sort of assimilate into, oh, this is what this is. I mean, at first it just felt good, you know what I mean?
So sure.
You go where it feels good.
When I was young, I spent my summer day playing on the track. The sound of the wheels rolling on the steel took me out, took me back. Big train from Memphis, big train from Memphis. Now it's gone, 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 gone. Like no one before, he let out a roar, and I just had to take along. Each night I went to bed with the sound in my head.
Big Train from Memphis, that's our guest John Fogerty from the album Centerfield, an album he played every instrument on. Now that story and so much more is in his latest memoir, Fortunate Son. We'll go back a bit. You grew up in El Cerrito, California, which is might surprise people that don't know the story because they probably just assume you grew up in the swamplands of Louisiana or something.
Well, my early influence is really, especially from records, I think is what came out of me later, you know, when I began to actually write my own songs that anyone ever heard about anyway. You know, all my early influences were people like Bo Diddley or Howlin' Wolf or Elvis Presley or Jimmy Rogers, you know, the one from Mississippi. Well, actually, they're both from Mississippi, but the singing brake man, the blue yodeler.
Yeah.
You know, so there was a lot of blues and country mixed up in what I loved as a kid. And, of course, American culture being what it is, there was also movies and books, things like Mark Twain, of course, that I was just fascinated with. For some reason, it all just felt natural to me. So when I, you know, grew up and I started writing songs, you know, my first really, really good song was Proud Mary. And it just, I don't know where it came from. But there I was in the swamp.
You mentioned Proud Mary, and you had the song title for a long time, which is really cool, and you didn't know what it meant, and then finally it hit.
Yeah, this is a strange... the tale of Proud Mary is almost, when I look at it, it's kind of a straight line. It's sort of a long time to develop, but if you look at it with hindsight, it just looked like a straight line, almost like I was guided to do this or something. I got off active duty from the Army in the summer of 67, and pretty quickly I decided that I needed to get organized if I was really going to make music my life's work, meaning try to earn a living at it.
Yeah.
Because up until then, all I ever did was, you know, I got inspired every once in a while, and I'd try to find a napkin or a piece of paper and a crayon, perhaps, to write something down. Pretty haphazard. And now I was feeling like if I get organized, it might go a little smoother. So I went and went down to the local store, got a little notebook and some binder paper, and dutifully put that in the book and came home. And on the front page, I wrote song titles very optimistically, you know.
Yeah.
Little time went by. I don't know if it was a couple of days or a week or really what, but I found myself with the phrase Proud Mary in my head. And I had no idea what that meant. But it sounded kind of cool, kind of mysterious, so I wrote it down. It's actually the very first entry in that book, which I still have, by the way, and I still use. I mean, I haven't quite filled all the pages in yet. And then later, much later, it's about 8 months, 8-9 months, in about June of 68, I was trying to get out of the Army. I was trying to get off this Army Reserve unit I was in because I wanted to grow long hair and be a rock star, and they were kind of putting a clamp on that. Well, after working on it for some time, I found my honorable discharge from the Army out laying on the steps to my apartment, and man, that was one of the wonderful moments of my life. I mean, I was so happy. This was the height of the Vietnam War. I went right in the house and started strumming on my Rickenbacker, not plugged in, just, you know, the acoustic way that a Rickenbacker sounds. And lo and behold, I started writing, left a good job in the city, working for the man every night and day. And suddenly I'm kind of touching on the Mississippi River and singing about rolling. I need to pull this together. What's this about? And I went back to my songwriting title book. I open it up, and there it says Proud Mary, and it just hits me. Wow, that's the name of the boat. This is about a boat.
Wow.
And then, you know, it all kind of came together. Just an amazing little journey right there in my living room.
That's amazing.